Good morning, Fellowship Community Church. Thank you for joining us today. These certainly are unusual days, but I'm hoping that you're taking the time to pause and see the good things that God's doing. We've heard of many of the ways that you're trying to stay connected through Zoom meetings and cards and notes, even yellow boxes dropped off on doorsteps. We want to encourage you to keep that up. In fact, I challenge you to get out the church directory or go online to CCB and get the name of somebody maybe you don't even know and pray for them. Send them a note, send them a card or an email, or even better yet, give them a call. It's in these times that we can really come to know and appreciate God. And we as a staff want you to know that we are continuing to be in prayer for all of you. So keep sending us those praise and prayer requests. With the stay-at-home order, it's been great to hear that our kids and our youth are reading and studying the Bible even more. And I hope you're doing that too. This pandemic time will end, so let's make sure that we take advantage of it. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for who you are, the sovereign Lord of all. We lift up all those that are affected by this pandemic, whether it be health-wise, job-wise, or any other way. God, we ask that you give guidance and wisdom to our leaders and peace to our people. Lord, we thank you for those that are on the front line and ask that you would keep them healthy and keep them safe. We thank you for all of your blessings. But most of all, God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Now, I brought along my little friends. These are the Gospel Fuzzies. Now, all of you kids should know this. But they tell a really cool story. In fact, Gold tells us of God's love. Now, God lives in heaven. And the Bible tells us that the streets of heaven are paved like gold. And so that he tells us about God. He reminds me that someday I could be with God. I could be with him in heaven. But we've all sinned. And Dark reminds me of the sin. Sin separates us from God. He keeps us from ever being in heaven. But you know what? We've all sinned. We've all done things that make God sad. Sin is anything that we say or do or even think that makes God sad. And Romans 3:23 tells us, for all have sinned. But you know what? God loves us, even though we've sinned. In fact, that's why he sent his Son, Jesus. His Son, Jesus, died on the cross to take the punishment of our sin. He died so that you and I could someday be in heaven with God. In fact, we believe that Jesus is God and that he died on the cross for us. He died so that our sins could be forgiven. But you know what? He didn't stay dead. He came back alive. And that proves that he is God. In fact, if we believe on Jesus, the Bible tells us that we are children of God and that we can be with him in heaven someday. All we have to do is believe. That's all. Believe that Jesus is God, that he died on the cross for the punishment of our sins, and that he rose again. And if we choose Jesus as the only one that can save us from the punishment of our sins, then we can go to heaven and be with God. And if we do that, then God wants us to grow and grow more in him. He wants us to learn more about him. God knows everything about us, but he wants us to grow more and more in him and more like Jesus. Now, these guys tell a great story, but you know what? They sing a really cool song. So, kids, I know you know this, so sing it with me, okay?
We are the Gospel Fuzzies. We are the Gospel Fuzzies. We are the Gospel Fuzzies with good news for you and me. Gold tells of God's love. Gold tells of God's love. Gold tells of God's love. He loves you and me. dark says I have sinned. Dark says I have sinned. Dark says I have sinned and I can't hide from him. Red means Jesus died. Red means Jesus died. Red means Jesus died, but he rose again. White means I am saved. White means I am saved. White means I am saved when I trust in him. Green means that I'm growing. Green means that I'm growing. Green means that I'm growing more and more in him. We are the gospel fuzzies. We are the gospel fuzzies. We are the gospel fuzzies with good news for you and me.
All right, way to go, kids. All right, let's continue in worship now with a song from Rob.
Hey, everybody. Rob from the worship team here. I just wanted to share a song with you this week that I've always gone back to when I feel like I'm in a place where I don't really know all the answers, or I feel like I'm not really connecting with God the way I should, whether it's because I'm, you know, not in Scripture as much as I should, or I'm not praying as much as I should. This is a song that I actually taught myself how to play the guitar on, and is really touches me every time I play it, sing it, hear it. So I'm hoping it'll do the same for you. And as we all try to get through this COVID-19 issue, you can tell I'm wearing the hat today because my hair's out of whack. I haven't had a haircut in over a month, and that's driving me nuts. And just life seems all crazy right now. So hopefully you can take a step back with me and get back to the heart of worship.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. And though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, And it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. You're looking into my heart, looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Hi, my name is Marie Welch, and I have the blessing of being able to serve on the staff at Fellowship Community Church as the Director of Operations. One of the hard things about this current crisis of masks and confinement is not being able to share with people about the love of my life, which is Jesus. And one of the things that's been good about it is I've had more opportunity to just be in the Word and to reflect even on how I came to Christ so many years ago. Pastor asked me if I'd be willing to share my testimony, and I'm always happy to talk about Jesus. I grew up going to church. I don't remember ever not going to church. Kind of joke about being christened a Presbyterian and confirmed a Methodist and then dunked a Baptist, so I think I have all my bases covered there. I can't ever remember not knowing that Jesus died on the cross and he rose again on the third day. But what I didn't know is that he did that for me. As I grew older, I tried to read my Bible and it didn't make sense to me. I knew there was something missing, but I didn't know what it was and I didn't know how to find it. It wasn't until I met this tall, handsome, good-looking guy that would become my husband that I heard for the first time that Jesus did go to the cross and he died and he rose again and he did it to pay the price for my sins. I had a hard time with that at first because I had only heard about how to be good. And for the most part, I was a good girl. That was just my nature, and I was a good girl. So I had a hard time with that whole sin concept. But the more that Rich talked to me and the more that I learned, the more I realized that I could never be good enough. No matter how hard I tried, I was never going to be good enough. One night after dating Rich for about 9 months, we were at a youth crusade. A group of kids had come from Texas, and they were putting on a weeks-long kind of Bible study or crusade, if you will, and we went every night. And one night, they played a song, called A Savior is Waiting. And I heard the words, "A Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why won't you let him come in?" And I knew then what I needed to do. And I opened the door of my heart and I asked Jesus to come in and save me from my sins and to be my Savior, to be my Lord. That was almost 50 years ago. The Bible made sense. The emptiness that I had felt for all those years wasn't there anymore. I wasn't empty. I've walked with Jesus now, as I said, for almost 50 years. And it is his sovereignty and his love and his faithfulness that sustains me. And in this past year, as I've had to say goodbye, or I'll see you soon, to the love of my earthly life, my husband, it continues to be the love and faithfulness and sovereignty of Jesus that keeps me going and sustains me. And if anything, during this crisis, I've learned to love him more, to walk with him more closely. It's been the greatest joy of my life to be his daughter.
Good morning, and welcome again to Fellowship Community Church by way of video. I'm sitting here in our hallway. Many of you will recognize this. And behind me, we have many of the verses that we have chosen over the last 10 years as verses for the year. In 2020, we chose from Psalm 100 the phrase, "Serve the Lord with gladness." And wow, that just seems like now to be such a perfect verse for us in this season of the coronavirus 19. And may God help us to continue to serve the Lord with gladness. I'd like to begin the message this morning from Philippians with the story of Blaise Pascal. He was a 17th century scientist and mathematician and also known to be quite the philosopher. Pascal was born in 1623 and he died in 1662. He was a scientist of some renown. He invented the first wristwatch. He invented the first syringe. He was known for his math expertise from the time he was a child. His mother died when he was young, and his father moved the family to Paris so he could be well educated. He loved math so much, that's all he wanted to study. He developed something called the Pascal triangle, and it is still used today to discern probabilities and percentages and geometric solutions. He was quite a man. He also developed the first calculator. Worked on it for years. Problem was, it was so expensive that nobody really owned one. In theology, Pascal came up with something called the Pascal wager. And this was a brand new thought in the 17th century and maybe fresh for us today. Pascal would contend that to believe in God gave you a better life on the earth. So he said, "I choose to believe in God," being a logical, mathematical type man, "I choose to believe in God. And if when I die, I discover that God actually didn't really exist, I'd still choose to believe in God because life on the earth is better when you have faith in God." For Pascal, faith in God wasn't enough. He also had personally put his faith and trust in Jesus Christ. When he was 31 years old in 1654, he came to that decision to put all of his trust in Christ. And this is what he wrote. "May I not fall from him forever. This is life eternal, that they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent." It's a quote from John 17:3, the words of Jesus. "Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, I have fallen away, I have fled from him, denied him, crucified him. May I not fall from him forever. We hold him only by the ways taught in the gospel. Renunciation total and sweet, total submission to Jesus Christ and to my director. Eternally enjoy for a day's exercise on earth. I will not forget thy word. Amen. Pascal so loved those words and the decision he made at the age of 31 that he wrote them down and he put them in a little locket which he hung around his neck for the rest of his life as a daily reminder of his commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. Very sadly, he died 8 years after that decision at the age of 39 because of a stomach tumor. But his life had been radically transformed by the power of Jesus Christ. He's a very intelligent man, maybe an outstanding scholar of his day, yet he chose to believe on Jesus. And when we believe on Jesus, he does indeed transform our lives. This is what we believe here at Fellowship Community Church. We put it down in a mission statement about 10 years ago or so. It says this: we invite all generations and all cultures to share life together that all might be transformed by the power of Jesus Christ. It's a very broad statement, very ambitious, if you will. All generations, every age, all cultures, our church has many different people from many different cultures, share life together. And life is an acrostic of our core values as a church. We believe these are our priorities: to love God and love others, to be instructed by God's word, to have fellowship with other believers, and to seek to evangelize those who do not yet know Jesus. The way we propose to do this is by staying connected with Christ personally and as a body of believers, connected with Christ, and then to connect in community with one another and other believers. My, how that's been challenged in this season we're living in now, but we're doing it and we'll continue to do so, so that by the connection with Christ and the connection in community, we will be ready to connect to the culture of those around us who do not yet know Christ. This really comes from Jesus' words. After he had arisen from the dead and before he ascended back into heaven, he gave his disciples, his apostles, this great commission. I'm reading from Matthew chapter 28 and verse 16. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. I've always tripped over that word. Why were they doubting the one they're worshiping? I don't think the doubts were about Jesus. He was there in his glorified, resurrected human body. But they were doubting themselves. And understandably so. They had denied him, run away from him. They weren't there at the cross, and in their fear, they were locked away in a room as we looked at Easter. And then he appeared. And he said, as the Father has sent me, I'm sending you. Well, now here he echoes that again. All authority, he said, in heaven and on earth has been given to me. He has absolute supreme authority that he shares with the Father and the Spirit. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. This is the purpose of the church. This is why we gather. This is why we hold fast to the gospel. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. The main verb of the command is to make disciples. A disciple is one who is a learner, one who puts into practice what they learn. And so another way to say it is a follower of the Lord Jesus. This command is surrounded by three participles: going, baptizing, and teaching. So it is a process. It begins with going into all the world, going to all nations. Wherever you go, whenever you go, there is the command upon you as my disciples to go and make disciples. Going takes a long time. Rarely does someone put their trust in Christ the first moment they hear the gospel. And that going leads to a decision to believe on Christ, as Pascal did in his testimony, with full submission. He put his trust in Christ. And so the Great Commission says, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Now, this is not a long process. It's a moment of decision. Baptism of believers is an outward sign of an inward reality. I believe on Jesus and I'm identified with him. And so I want to be baptized in water to declare my decision. And we're baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, all three persons of the Trinity. And then that follows a lifelong process of learning to obey what he has taught us, teaching them to observe or obey all that I have commanded you. Jesus didn't give us a list of suggestions. He gives us a list of commands. And as the one who has all authority in heaven and earth and under the earth, he has the right to command us. And we are obligated joyfully to obey him. And then he concludes this great commission with those words, "Behold, I am with you always to the very end of the age." Jesus is always going to be with those who are seeking to make disciples. This is really what the church is all about. And is why we are called to be a church and called to follow him. This morning from Philippians chapter 3, we're going to see how Saul of Tarshish was turned into the Apostle Paul. Really, Paul in this section gives us his very personal testimony, his life story, if you will, of how his life was radically transformed by Jesus Christ. I'm reading from Philippians 3, and I'll begin at verse 1, some verses we looked at last week as it flows into the text for this week. "Finally, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble to me and is safe for you. Look out for those dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh." We said last week they were Judaizers. "For we are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also. If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law a Pharisee, as to zeal persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him and his death, that by any means possible I may attain to the resurrection from the dead." Now, Paul's testimony follows a simple three-part outline. He describes in verses 4 to 6 his life before he met Christ. And then in verses 7 to 9, he describes exactly and precisely how he met Christ, how he decided to follow Christ as a disciple. And then the last verses, 10 and 11, he gives us a brief introduction to what his life has been like since he met Christ, his life after he began to follow Christ. Now, this is a very simple outline and one that we should be prepared to share with others about our life story. First, what was his life like before he met Christ? I think he would summarize it and say it was a total loss. But he shares us with precision about his life. "Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh." Confidence, being fully persuaded that I'm okay because of my accomplishments in the flesh. First, he talks about his pedigree, and then he talks about the choices he made based on his pedigree in his life. This is a direct rebuke to the Judaizers who were boasting about their pedigree and about their accomplishments. These are advantages that he had that he was born with. He was circumcised on the eighth day. He was circumcised precisely as the law commanded it. In Leviticus 12 and verse 3, it says, a child, a little boy, should be circumcised on the eighth day. And Paul was. And he was from the people of Israel, the chosen people. And he's of the tribe of Benjamin, the tribe that remained faithful to the Lord in the southern kingdom with Judah even after the captivity. And he's a Hebrew of Hebrews, which suggests that his parents were Hebrews also, and may suggest that he has a long line of Jewish people in his life lineage. Now, those are his pedigrees, but then comes his choices, the things that he chose to do, the choices he made in his life. He chose to become a Pharisee. As to the law, he says, a Pharisee. This is the most strict group in Israel. Pharisee means separate. They separated themselves from everybody else. They believed in a literal interpretation of the Word of God. Josephus, the Jewish historian, says that during the time of Jesus, there were about 6,000 Pharisees. I was shocked to learn that. It sounds like a very small number to me, and I'm very surprised. They had added to the Old Testament law 613 extra laws that they sought to follow. Unfortunately, Jesus rebuked the Pharisees because he said that what they had done is adding these laws, they had nullified, made void, the real intent of God's commands. He said of them, "Well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites." This is Mark chapter 7 and verse 6. "As it is written, this people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men." And remember, 613 they added. "You leave the commandment of God and hold to the tradition of men. You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition. For Moses said," as an example, "honor your father and mother, and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. But you say, if a man tells his father or his mother, 'Whatever you would have gained from me is Corban, that is given to God,' then you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother, thus making void or nullifying the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down. And many such things you do." When I read those words of Jesus' rebuke of the Pharisees, I admit I shudder. Do I put traditions of myself or my church or my ideas ahead of the Word of God? That's a stern rebuke. But Paul was a Pharisee. He belonged to that strict group. The ones who were mentioned as strict, respected as strict, but who were doing all this for the recognition of men rather than the honor of God. "As to his zeal," he says, "I persecuted the church." He was so committed to the idea of Judaism and the law of Moses that he actually hunted down believers. In Acts chapter 9, we read that he was on his way to Damascus to do this when he actually met the Lord Jesus Christ. "As for his performance record, as to righteousness under the law, I'm blameless. I'm seen to be the top of the heap. I have followed the laws, not only of the Old Testament, but of those added by the tradition of the Pharisees. If you want to get into a battle with me of a credential battle of who's doing the best, you Judaizers," Paul's saying, "I'm going to win that battle because my qualifications, my credentials are precise. They're without equal." You see, Paul understood that if we leave God out, if we leave him out of our lives, it opens the door to the devil to come in. When you reject the free gift of God and try by your own performance to gain acceptance with God, you're bound to fail. St. Bonaventure, a Catholic theologian, said it this way years ago: "When you are too sure of yourself, you are less on guard against the enemy. Be alert, therefore, for the devil who, if he can claim even one hair of your head, will lose no time in making a braid of it." was your life like before you met Christ? Were you seeking to earn your way to heaven by your own accomplishments? Did you look to your pedigree and the decisions of your life as some way to earn acceptance with God, earn your way to heaven? Many people do. And every religion of the world seeks to do that apart from Christianity. How did Paul or Saul of Tarshish actually meet Jesus Christ? Well, let me read that to you from Acts chapter 9. It's recorded there. Paul told the story again many times. But here's what Luke wrote down in his letter of Acts in chapter 9. But Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest, Acts 9:1, and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, which is Christianity, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. And falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, that is, Saul said, who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But rise and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do. So it was by that miraculous conversion, that decision, by the appearance of the resurrected Lord Jesus, that Saul's life was transformed, and he took on the Gentile name, for he was the Gentile apostle, if you will. He took on the name Paul. Look again at Philippians chapter 3. We begin at verse 7, but in great contrast to all his accomplishments of his pedigree and his decisions, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Now, I want to look precisely at these words. I am particularly interested at the verbs that he uses. But all or whatever were gains to me, that's actually in the plural, whatever accomplishments I had, whatever profits I had earned, they were in the past. Whatever I had, what used to be, we could translate it, what used to be gains for me, I now consider or count as one big loss. When I evaluate all those gains, I come to the conclusion that they were just one big loss. This is a decision I had made. I made it at that time, and I continue to hold to the truth that those gains I thought I had and I held to are now just one big loss. It's in the singular, for the sake of Christ. For the sake of Christ, or on account of Christ. And then he repeats the thought again. Now here, he began with gains, and he went to loss. And when he repeats it, he begins with a loss, and he goes to the gain. And that's a very clever way of Paul emphasizing this. So he began with his gains, and then he said it was a loss, and then he repeats the loss, and he goes back to the gains. Verse 8, indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. I now personally consider and continue to count or consider everything universally as one big loss. Because, the reason for this is because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. The surpassing worth, the worth that's beyond words to describe, the ultimate value of the knowledge, actually it's a noun, the knowledge or knowing Christ. Not just an intellectual decision, but an ongoing relationship. Christ Jesus my Lord. That is the only time in all of Paul's letters when he calls Jesus my Lord personally. Very, very striking. Of course he believed that Jesus was his Lord, but this is the only place he actually says it in the letter. For his sake, or on account of him, I lost I have suffered the loss of all things. I have lost them. They're in the past. It's just one big loss. And I now consider again, or I now count them as I evaluate it as rubbish. Rubbish is actually a tame translation of the word. I almost blush to tell you what it means. It's not garbage. It's not just loss. It actually means excrement of an animal. He's saying, and compared to knowing Christ and having a relationship with Him, all those accomplishments are like dog dirt. Like dog dirt. Compared with the value of gaining Christ, of having gained Christ on that day when I decided I have Him and I'll forever have Him, Christ. In verse 9, and to be found in Him, to be found in Him. I have been found in Him and I will continue to be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law. You see, that's what it was like before I knew Christ. I'm trying to earn it on my way, but I don't have that, and I never really did have it. But that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith alone. You see how he states it so clearly? The greatest contrast possible, his trying to earn his righteousness with God by performance, he says, it's nothing compared to the reality of knowing the righteousness that is a gift from God, and it comes by faith alone. The gain-loss picture is a picture of scales. If you put all my accomplishment, Paul says, on a scale, and it looks pretty impressive, but then you put knowing Christ, boom. Everything falls to knowing Christ. The surpassing value, the ultimate value of simply knowing Christ, having a relationship with Him. Intellectually, yes, but also my will and my heart surrendered to Him. It's all by faith. All the religions that the devil has invented from the beginning are based on works performance. Do this, pay this, you know, spend your time with this. But the gospel, the true gospel, is a free gift. As Paul writes to the Ephesians, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. It's the gift of God, not of works, so that no one can boast. That's Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. And that's what Paul wants us to understand from this passage. The moment he met Christ, it was a decision of his mind, of his emotion, and his will, and it's a relationship with God through Christ. So you say, Paul, what was life like after that moment? What is life like as you begin to follow Christ? Well, he tells us in verse 10 and 11. I only have time today to kind of begin to explore this with you. We'll pick it up again next week. That I may know Him, that's the umbrella statement, that I may know Him, and that's my top priority, knowing Him, and the power of His resurrection, and may share in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. So there are three aspects to this knowing Christ that he wants us to understand. The power of His resurrection. The power of the fact that Jesus rose again from the dead. It's the Greek word dunamis. We get our word dynamite from it, but this power doesn't explode things. It actually brings things together. And Paul uses it many times. In fact, the apostles spoke often of the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In Acts 4 and verse 33, it says, and with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. They spoke of the power of the Lord Jesus. Paul speaks of the power of the resurrection of Jesus in the introduction to the letter to Romans. And he, that is Jesus, was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by His resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. So power and resurrection are often a theme in the Scriptures. And secondly, the fellowship of His sufferings. the theme of suffering is prominent in this letter of Philippians. Paul, as you remember, was imprisoned for preaching the gospel. In a sermon entitled Living for Jesus, Francis Chan talks about his own experience. That when he became a Christian in the 80s, he writes, I was taught much about the benefits of accepting Christ, but little about the cost. It wasn't until a few years ago that I was taught about the actual joy that could come with suffering. It took a while for me to believe it. While I used to pray that I could skate through this earth with little suffering, I now pray that with Paul, that I could share in Christ's sufferings. That's quite a shift of perspective. And becoming like him in his death. That's the way Paul says it. Becoming like him in his death. Taking on the form of very death. Dying to myself and living for Christ alone who indwells me. That somehow, by some means, I may attain to the resurrection from out of the dead. Which is looking in the future to the glorified, resurrected body that is promised to all who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. I think Chan's story of not being told about suffering for Christ is too common today. Many are following Christ expecting it to be a very easy life when in fact it really isn't. I have a very good friend by the name of Ed Iwan. He's now in heaven. Ed was a missionary with Sudan Interior Mission in Kenya. And he dealt primarily with people who had no interest in the gospel and ministered there for years with very little fruit shown. His son followed him there, and there's been fruit since. But at the time Ed served with his wife Eleanor, it was very difficult. And I can remember often praying with Ed, and Ed would pray something like this, Lord, keep me from the easy life. I was shocked at first when he said that, but looking at his life, I could see that that's precisely what he did. He didn't choose the easy life. The great missionary Elizabeth Elliot said it this way, personal sacrifice paves the way for God's miracles. Let me say that again. Personal sacrifice paves the way for God's miracles. May we embrace the faith of the Apostle Paul, that the life lived in communion with Christ, knowing that he is indwelling us, is a life where we want to know him and the power of the resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings somehow to attain to the resurrection from out of the dead. Paul himself spoke like this, that it wasn't easy to follow Christ for him. The last letter he wrote, 2 Timothy, when he is going to his execution and going to lose his head, he said, I am already being poured out as a drink offering. This is 2 Timothy 4:6. And the time of my departure is come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. I have kept it. I have guarded it. I made the decision to keep it long ago, and I have continued to make good on that confession. I retain it in custody. I protect it, and I obey it. This is an expression of both his doctrinal faith and his duty as a disciple. He is willing to follow Christ at any cost. In that same sermon, Francis Chan speaks of the less than admirable reasons that people come to church, that people say they follow Christ. He says that many people are glad to follow Christ if he gives them what they want. You know, churches are filled with people every week with promises of money and health. I will follow Jesus if I get the right job. I will follow Jesus if I have the right car. I will follow Jesus if I get the job. I will follow Jesus if I remain healthy. And Chan rightly says this false gospel is being preached around the world today. And in many impoverished nations it is preached. And it is leading many people astray because they pray and they seek to follow Jesus with that if. I'll take Jesus if I can still be popular. I'll take Jesus if I can have this or have that. But he concludes this with this word. The biblical gospel has never been about I'll come to Jesus if. The biblical gospel has always been about I'll follow Jesus even if. That sums it up. That sums it up so very well. If I was to summarize what we've seen in Philippians chapter 3 today, of the testimony of the Apostle Paul, what his life was like before he knew Christ, it was a total loss. And what it was so glorious when he met Christ, it was an infinite gain. And he continues to live out that life of knowing Christ in spite of the suffering with great joy. I would summarize it this way. Total loss led to total gain of knowing Christ by faith alone. I want you to think about that as Alyssa McCampbell is going to come and sing a song before we close this service today. What is your life? Do you know Christ? I pray that you will know him and follow him, even if.
So here it is, my alabaster heart. I'm keeping nothing back from who you are. No hidden treasure veiled by key or lock. You're a lifetime worth of worship, and that's only just the start. Here it is, my every waking day. The minutes, hours, the years of endless praise. For you're worthy far beyond all I could say. There's a lifetime worth of worship in the nuance of your names. So let it rise. I can sense my whole life, a fragrance every ounce, here broken at your feet. Every breath an offering, my heart cries, these lungs sing over you, my worthy King of Kings.
Bye.
can have it all. On my heart and on my soul, all I own, you can have it all. On my love, on my love, on my love, you can have it all. On my love, on my love, on my love, you can have it all. On my heart and on my soul, all I own, you can have it all. On my heart and on my soul, all I own, you can have it all. On my love, on my love, on my love, you can have it all. On my love, on my love, on my love, you can have it all. On my heart and on my soul, all I own, you can have it all. On my heart and on my soul, all I own, you can have it all. You can have it all. Oh, you can have it all. You can have it all. My incense, my whole life, a fragrance every hour. You're broken at your feet. Every breath and offering, my heart cries, these lungs sing over you, my worthy King of Kings. Let it rise like incense, my whole life, a fragrance every ounce. Tears spilled out at your feet. Every breath is my offering. My heart cries, these lungs sing over you, my worthy King of Kings.
So I want to thank Alyssa for singing that great song. I just love the intent of that song. In conclusion of our service today, I invited my son Ben to come along. Benjamin, when he was a newborn baby, reached out and grabbed my little pinky finger, and I realized we had named him correctly, the son of my right hand. Ben, I'm so thankful you're here today, and I remember teaching you Bible verses. Do you remember the very first Bible verse that I taught you?
I do. I remember very well. Every night before bed, not every night, but we would read the Pilgrim's Progress occasionally, and he would always quote Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. And it always struck me, or maybe it didn't always strike me, but as a child, the verse has meaning. I remember explaining to my nephew the other day, the wages of sin. What does that really mean, Lucas? What are the wages of sin? And even as an adult now, it becomes more real to me that Jesus, he settled the debt. His death on the cross truly settled the debt of my sins.
Mm. It's very interesting how Paul put that together in direct contrast. Wages of sin is death. Mm. The gift of God is eternal life. And they are in direct contrast with each other. I'd like to finish the service today by giving the folks an illustration of how life can be so rich when we embrace Christ. Now, I know, Ben, that you really like cranberry juice, so I bought a couple jars of cranberry juice for you to taste test for me today. So this is one of your favorites, Ocean Spray, 100% cranberry juice, no sugar added.
No sugar added.
No yes. sugar added. So I want you to take a little yes. taste of this. See what you think of that.
No sugar added.
It's what you like,
cranberry
right?
Cranberry juice. Yeah, that's right.
That's awesome.
That's exactly what I like.
That's what you like. Now, this one is also called cranberry juice, and it's called just cranberry. And why don't you take a little taste test of this? It looks the same.
Also, no sugar added.
Yeah, no sugar added.
That is cranberry juice. And that is truly no sugar added.
So, what's really interesting is that even though this bottle says that no sugar's added and that it's straight cranberry juice, when I look at the ingredients, I see it's got grape juice and it's got apple juice and it's got other concentrates and cherry juice and some plum juice and some natural flavor and on the list goes. Now, Ben, read for the folks what it says on the jar of just cranberry juice.
Filtered water, cranberry juice.
That's all it is.
Yes.
Which do you think's better for you, Ben?
Better for me?
Yeah.
Better for my body?
Sweet tasting cranberry juice the straight stuff?
Right, yeah, the straight up cranberry juice like they show in the commercials type of stuff. Right?
Yeah. How about that? So the illustration that we want to conclude with is this. The gospel can sometimes be tough to swallow. It can be difficult. It includes sufferings of Christ. And that isn't easy. But in the end, it's much better. It's much more satisfying. And the gospel can't be mixed with anything else. Jesus said it clearly. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And as Paul said today, the gain of having Christ and a relationship with him is far superior, even if it includes suffering. So let me say this. We want our lives to be full of Jesus Christ, not just flavored with Jesus Christ. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Ben, how about you close us out with a word of prayer?
Sure. Lord, thank you for this time I get to spend with my dad once again. Lord, this epidemic has brought many opportunities for me to spend more time with my family, and I pray that that's been the case for other teenagers and other young adults and other families in general, Lord. We thank you for this time, although it's uneasy, although it's unsettling, although there are many unanswered questions. God, we know that you're in control. We know that you are ultimately the king, and let us focus on your kingdom as we embark on this journey of life that is so difficult and so unprecedented, Lord. We look to you for peace because we know that you grant it, and we thank you for all that you do and continue to do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.